Let's talk about your son, Kevan. Kevan, first and foremost, how many children do you have?
Five.
You have five kids.
Five.
Where does Kevan fall in the line?
That's the first one. That's the first one born. He's the oldest.
Okay.
The only boy.
That's your first boy. That's your first one born.
Yeah.
Were you in Kevin's life as a youngster?
You know what? I was his brother instead of his father.
Whoa. Elaborate. What do you mean?
That means that when he was born, me and his mother wasn't in a real relationship. You know, I was young. I was 18 years old. You know what I'm saying? I was running around. At that particular time is when it was shoot him up, gun him up. I didn't have time for no son. I had a son for a fad. Oh, yeah, Barnes got a son over there in the project. Yeah. That's my baby mother, Builder 3. You know, that type of thing. But never knew the understanding of what a father was. You know what I'm saying? My father left, like I said, when I was 13. So I never really had that understanding. I'm thinking as long as I'm out here getting money and he fly, he got the latest sneakers at 1 year old, I'm being a good pops. You know what I'm saying? And that's what I'm literally thinking. But that next year is when I went away the first time and I came back and he was 6 years old.
Mm.
And now I'm trying to play catch up. You know what I'm saying? I'm still not out here for him. Now the feds come to get me and I got to go away to the feds now. You know what I'm saying? So now I'm in the feds for another 4 years. When I come back, he's 12 years old now. You know what I'm saying? Okay, who are you? Like, even though he came to the jail, he did this, that, and the other, it's still, who are you? Because I've been living with my mother boyfriend for the last 11 years, and that's who I look up to. And we kind of feel like we want to push them away because they're not showing us love. Like, not that you've been here for the last, we just automatically think, well, as long as I give them some money, it's cool, it was good, and it wasn't that. So, I wasn't there for him. You know what I'm saying? I could really say I wasn't there for him. And when he did get 17 and 18 and I was there for him, it was more or less, I'm your brother now. Let's talk to girls. You know, let's do this, that, and the other, because your pops is only 34. You 18, 19. You know, let's roll out together. I got him around Puff. I got him inside the clubs and everything. I'm just the coolest pops. Never once can I tell you, Prez, that I really sat down with him through all that because I was too busy trying to be cool to ask him really what's going on in life. My son played in the Rucker tournament. You know what I'm saying? My son played for Mary Bertram High School. My son played for Rice High School. It's write-ups about him all in the newspapers. Everything. He got a scholarship to basketball, same school that Lamar Odom went to. You know what I'm saying? But because of peer pressure, because of different things, he left the school. He came back to Harlem. He came back to New York. And that's where I say me being a father wasn't there, because now I was supposed to have that talk. Okay, you're back now. What are you going to do? It was schools trying to get him to play. And I was moving so fast that I wasn't listening to the reason that he wasn't going to these schools was because they were B leagues or C leagues. You know what I'm saying? It might have been Long Island University or something like that wants him to play. Oh, no, I'm not playing for them. But if I was a father, I would have told him what I want to tell a youth now. Even if you don't play NBA, you're getting a free scholarship. You're getting free education. This is the stuff that I was supposed to do back then. Oh, okay, slow down. I know basketball is your love, but just in case you don't, dad don't got $100,000 a year for you to go to school. Let's take advantage of this. You know what I'm saying? So I failed him there. You know what I'm saying? Because I was running around doing other things. You know what I'm saying? Even though they were the right things at this time, I never looked back to say, okay, I lived my life. Let me make sure my son's life is together. I'm seeing little things, you know, he's had a baby. Okay. He's had, God bless him. The baby died. He turned around, had another baby. Boom, boom, boom. Okay. He's working. All right. He's here at Starbucks. He's boxing in the gym. Okay. This was all I was concerned about, but I never had that talk to say, where are you financially? what is going on? You know what I'm saying? What is your next plan now that you're not going to school? What's the next plan? Stuff that a father is supposed to say. But as long as he was looking good, and when he strayed, and as long as he was looking good, I felt like he was all right. But now I realize that was my excuse for not doing my job. That was my excuse for saying, same way some guys say, yo, I don't go around because my baby mother gave. That's the excuse that we all look for not to be bothered with our children. Because our children ain't going nowhere. They didn't say they don't want to be bothered. And if you really a father, you're going to keep coming. You're going to keep coming. As long as, and he ain't tell me that. You can't speak for my child. So it was those type of little things that always kept me away from them. And then when people think you're getting money, people think that you're supposed to do more things, and you don't have enough pride to tell a person, look, I'm only getting paid such and such because the picture looks so big to them that you want to keep the picture that big. You don't tell them I'm struggling just like you to pay my rent. I'm struggling just like you to pay my mortgage because you're around these people and they're making you feel like, yo, you getting used, like you know this. These people do this to everybody. You just feel like it's not gonna happen to you. So I never was there for him because I was so busy chasing something that I felt would give him a better life later on. But time stops for nobody because at the same time he's growing up to become a man and he's getting into situations and problems that any father is supposed to know about. But being that I'm running around thinking about myself first, I never stopped to see what was going on. So to say that, I was away one time and I got a phone call. And then when I picked up the phone, I was actually in Ibiza and it was the police officers. And they said, we got your son. I said, huh? They said, don't the police call nobody. They said, no, you know, we know who you are, yada, yada, we calling. Your son is locked up for a gun charge. So he had a gun charge. I came back, got the lawyer, went up to see him, said, nah, he's not ready to come out yet. It was just me talking to him. I've been there. I've sat there. You're not ready to come out. But he gets out. He gets a second gun charge, right? Now, this is two gun charges. So my lawyer said, let him sit there this time. Let him feel it. I'm going to handle it. He gets bailed out anyway. His mother bails him out. Okay, his brother-in-law bails him out. Nobody listens to me. I've been there. I've sat there. When you listen to people and you talk to people, you can tell when they're ready not to come out. So I came back in for Christmas with Puff, and I went to see him. He's out now. He's my son. So, of course, I'm going to smile. I'm going to be happy. You're free. Give me, you know how we was doing back then, Prez. We give you a box of Shawn John clothes here. You know what I'm saying? Take that. You know what I mean? So I knew he was good, gave him some money. And he said, Dad, I'm going to Africa. I said, oh, you going to Africa? Any father would sit there and question that way more than I did that night. Because I never even knew my son had a passport. But I was so busy, I came in on the 25th. Oh, I'm catching the flight. I got to be in Miami the 26th to, of course, make sure my client, make sure my friend, make sure, you know, P. Diddy is okay with his family on Christmas. But I never really stopped to get into debt of why he was going to Africa. He just said, Dad, all I was thinking about, honestly, was the two gun charges. And I said, okay. He must got a problem or a situation with somebody here. So I was actually happy he was going to Africa. You know what I'm saying? Like, yes, get out of here. You don't need to be here. But he said, yo, I'm going over here. I've never been out of the country. I want to see the town. I want to do some modeling. At that time, Tyson, Bedford, and everybody was doing the hip-hop hood modeling with the tattoos. And he said, I want to go out there and get some pictures and do everything. Cool, no problem. 2 weeks after that, I get a phone call while I'm in Paris and says that my son is incarcerated for marijuana. So I say, okay, I'm going out there. Yo, pay the $300. It was $300. When they paid the $300, they took the passport. When I actually landed in Africa, they said, no, he's incarcerated now. He's charged with murder.
Wow.
What's up, guys? Thanks for sticking with me to the end of the video. Truly appreciate you. If you like anything you heard here today, go ahead and hit that subscribe button. And if you know anybody that can benefit from this message, feel free to share. Peace and love.